I'd like to call our board meeting for February 8th to order. Our first order is a moment of silence. Let us stand for a pledge of allegiance.
The United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I want to thank all of you for being with us on tonight. We have our meeting tonight. We have for public comments, Brad Marin.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm here representing the Lee County Partners for the Advancement of Gifted Education, Lee County Page, and I want to publicly recognize the winners of our spelling bee that we held over this weekend, the first annual Lee County Page District Spelling Bee. And the winners are here with us tonight, and the first place champion, who will be representing Lee County at the Scripps National Spelling Bee in Washington, D.C., is Hunter Randolph. And I also would like to recognize the second place winner for the competition was his brother, Jay Randall. And the third place winner for the competition was Hunter Hoyle. I'd also like to thank all the assistance that we got from the schools and from the administration, Dr. Moss, Andy Bryan, Sharon Spence, and Dr. Carol Chappell, and all the members of the administration that made this a success. It started off with spelling bees at the classroom level throughout the district, in the third through the eighth grade, at the homeroom level, and the top two winners of each classroom were then elevated to a school-level competition. The school-level competition eliminated down to the three top spellers from each school, and then they competed again on Saturday for the district championship. So it was a good competition all the way around, and I think it was a great success and contributed to academic enrichment throughout the district. So I want to make sure to recognize them here in this forum.
What grade level are our winners from?
Hunter is in the sixth grade, Jay is in the eighth grade, and then Hunter Hoyle is in the fifth grade.
Standing. Good job. Congratulations again. Let's give them another round. And Brad, one last question for you before you go. What was the winning word?
The winning word was perilous.
God bless you. All right. We congratulations. It just continues to show the success of our young people, and we wish you luck in Washington, D.C. Wish you luck. All right. I'll entertain a motion for the approval of agenda.
Mr. Chairman, I move we approve the agenda as presented.
The move and probably second that we would approve the agenda as written. Are there any questions? Those in favor, let it known by saying aye.
Aye.
Those have the same sign. Ayes have it. Approval of our minutes from 1-18-2011.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the minutes for January the 18th, 2011.
Second.
Moving to the second that we would accept the minutes from 1-18-2011. You've heard the motion. Ready for the question. Joseph?
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
There is one slight correction on the last item on the front page.
Okay.
I'm listed as a vice chairman, and I didn't want to take Mr. Bernardi's authority, so that should be changed to board number.
Thank you, Dr. Smith. Over corrections, those in favor, let me know by saying aye.
Aye.
Those have the same sign. We want to recognize tonight Charlie Parks, County Commissioner Liaison, Ms. Emily Grimes is here from Fort Bragg, and Alexis from the Sanford Herald, and Margaret Murchison from our radio station. And to all of you, we appreciate you taking time out of your schedule to be with us on tonight. Dr. Moss.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And before I begin our announcements, let me also say that the spelling bee was so much a success that actually started to violate fire code with the crowd that was in attendance. And that is a wonderful problem to have, an absolute wonderful problem to have. So there was a lot of interest generated. And Mr. Marin did not request, but I would hope that the board would consider contributing financially to send the students to Washington, D.C. I know they have fundraisers going on through Page, but have not quite reached the goal. And any contribution from the Board of Education, especially since the student is representing Lee County Schools, we assist other students that are venturing off into competitive events, and hopefully this board would contribute financially to ensuring the student would be have a successful stay in Washington. And now it's my pleasure to recognize two of our own board members for the North Carolina School Board Association certificate for completion of hours of training. Sean Williams has successfully completed school board training and other activities in the area, in various areas, and successfully completed from 100 to 200 hours of contact time. So, Mr. Chairman.
Thanks, sir.
And Lynn Smith, also same category, 100 to 200 hours of contact training. If I may move right into superintendent report, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Let me introduce Andre Ramsure to the board to start off with. Andre, if you'll come forward. And hopefully you've prepared that 30-minute speech we talked about. It is indeed a pleasure to introduce Andre to the board. He was approved at the last board meeting to be the principal at Bragg Street Academy. Andre is an outstanding administrator. Not just because of his background and his love of learning, but because of his love for children. He'll do an outstanding job for us at Bragg or anywhere that we place him as an administrator. He's most recently been at Southern Lee High School, but he's also served in assistant principal roles at the middle school level as well and elementary. And when you see him interact with kids, you know that he truly cares about their success in life. And I think he'll be able to fill those big shoes that Carolyn Henry is leaving for us. And Andre, welcome aboard.
Thank you.
And Chris Dossenbach. Chris is replacing Andre. Chris has been a very successful teacher and is currently serving as an administrative intern. Has shown some very strong qualities for us, and I think he will be a great fit for Southern Lee High School. Already being very familiar with the students and the processes that are in place at Southern Lee under the leadership of Bonnie Allman. So, Chris, welcome into the ranks of administration. It's now indeed a pleasure to recognize another academic group. The Quiz Bowl winners, and I'll ask Ms. Bonnie Allman to introduce the students, and as she's coming up, let me say that they knocked off the reigning champs for, I believe, over 4 years running.
Right, they did.
So they are truly, truly in command of their academic skill and ability, and it's indeed an honor to have them part of our school system. Ms. Allman.
What I would like to do is we have two teachers that have stepped up in our school this year to work with the students in Quiz Bowl, and I would like to recognize them first. One is Ms. Laura Newman. She's one of our art teachers. And the other is Mr. Rob Newman. He is an avid teacher and a science teacher. And I'm going to ask Rob to come up and introduce the students, if that's okay.
That's fine.
Because he deserves it with all of his hard work he's done.
That's great. And it obviously without teacher advisor support and teacher additional time, effort, and energy they put in, we would not be successful. So we do appreciate all of your time and effort.
Yeah, this was our first team, and I know we didn't have one last year. I think maybe there was one prior to that, but these guys worked really hard. We had the youngest team, I know, because we actually have a freshman and two sophomores. But our team is, our captain was April Boggs. Our other senior was George Negron. Our junior here was Marquise Hackett. Jeffrey Davis and Justin Zhang were our two sophomores, and then our baby of the group, Carlos, he helped out tremendously. If I could, I would like their parents, because many of their parents are here, if they could just stand, because without them, you know, no matter what Laura and I did, it would not have been successful. So.
So with the youth on the team, we're expecting a dynasty. Is that it?
I hope so. That's my hope. That's my belief, too, because these are some really hardworking kids, and so I'm looking forward to next year, and we still have another competition, at least this year, with the spelling, the adult team spelling bee coming up in March. So we're looking forward to showing Southern Lee off again there.
Great. Thank all of you.
Thank you.
And I'll ask Sharon Spence if she'll come up and recognize our classroom webpage of the month.
Good evening. It's always a pleasure to stand before you and recognize our classroom webpage winner of the month. But I will tell you that it's getting harder and harder to choose a winner because our classroom pages are just getting better and better. So competition is fierce, but this evening's winner is Vincent Pinar. Vincent is a sixth grade math teacher at Sand Lee Middle School. And I'll ask Vincent to come up in just a minute. As we looked at the website nominations, webpage nominations, and went through the rubric, again, the scores were extremely high and extremely close. But Vincent's webpage scored a perfect 100. He has it all. And so we are very proud to introduce him to you as the winner and to put his webpage out there as the best practice for our other teachers. And so Vincent has tonight with him Kendall Wilson, principal at Sand Lee Middle School, and Trent Jones, assistant principal, who is also their webpage administrator for the school. And so I'd like to introduce Vincent to you.
Thank you.
And Vincent, we have for you a gift card as your monthly prize. And then Vincent is also, as you know, entered into a contest for an iPad at the end of the year. So thank you very much.
And I'll ask Dr. Jim Atkinson to come up and recognize our clean school of the month, which is, I think, becoming extremely difficult as we go down this road.
I will concur. Good evening. Dr. Moss mentioned it's getting more and more difficult for our staff to distinguish between the schools. I think the competition has been good for us, and as evidenced by the scores, we had 9 schools that did score over 90 this month. We did not have a winner last month because we didn't, the short month in December. So we had a little bit more to clean up. But Floyd Knight did a great job in winning that award with a score of 97. Excuse me, 98. They had 98, I'm gonna take that point away from you. But I do want to bring them up now and recognize them. Mr. Clifton Hooker, Harry Sellers, and Ms. Angela Cockman is the principal. And Ms. Cockman has been fighting the flu, so she may not be able to talk. I'm asking her to say a word.
You're doing a fine job.
But we do want to congratulate them and to offer them a token for their hard work, and we certainly do appreciate what they've done at their school and their location. And we didn't have anybody scoring the 70 this time, so don't.
We've got to have the sign.
Ah.
I thought you wanted to. Yeah, we need the sign.
Thank you, man.
Along those same lines, we did have two schools that tied for second. Deep River and Greenwood tied at 97. And Broadway came in third with 96. Bragg fourth at 94. We did have nine schools that scored above 90. So they are getting very serious about this competition, which is a good thing. It's now my pleasure to introduce and recognize Reed Cagle, who is the 2010 Governor's Award for Volunteer Service in Lee County. And as Reed's coming up, I know this service is for all of his work outside of Lee County schools. Reed does so much within Lee County schools that it would take me hours upon hours to describe it. He's most important to me, he's my partner in crime for things we'll have to do like this coming Thursday morning. Which is make a decision whether or not we'll have school. But Reed does an outstanding job, not only in his role with the Lee County School System as bus transportation director and coordinating the many safe miles that our buses travel and all of our automobile traffic, but he does a great job in our community, and his volunteer work, it speaks for itself. And Reed, we're just very blessed to have you as part of Lee County Schools, and the community is blessed to have you in the community.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate that. I appreciate the recognition and timing.
Thank you, Reed.
Board members, you have before you the dates for the extended for the meetings we'll have in the community. First one is February 10th at 6:30 at Wesley Middle School, February 22nd at Southernly High School, and then February 24th in the Broadway Auditorium. And then we'll have one February 28th starting at 5 p.m. with refreshments, 5:30 with the program at the McSwain Center. You're all invited to attend any or all of those sessions. They're open to the public. And we'll be gathering information and informing the public on where we stand with the budget as much as we know it. We also have family connections, getting ready for college. Now that I'm a junior, what do I do? Starting the process, April 11th. The location is yet to be determined. That typically is a very highly attended session. Based on your board retreat, you mentioned putting together some customer service sessions for our employees. We'll have the first one February 21st in the Assembly Room in the Hines Building from 8 to 11, and then May 3rd will be the second one, and that will be for anyone dealing with the public at any point in time. We're also working with the corporate department for Rosetta Stone to decide on a date and time for their CEO to come down to kick off Rosetta Stone for Lee County, similar fashion of what we've done with other business partners, like with Paxton Patterson and with the head of the class information. The last thing I wanted to mention was I can tell it's getting close to budget season. We've had our first of probably many public document requests, and what I plan to do this time is anytime I receive a public document request that concerns Lee County Schools, I'm going to inform the board as to where the public document request has come from and basically the intent with the public document. I think that's about the clearest way I know to be transparent with everything that we do. This public document request is from Charles Staley. I believe he's vice president or something within the local Republican Party. And he's requested the titles and salaries of every employee at the central office, principals, and average teacher pay. So we'll gather that information, received it yesterday, I believe, and we'll gather that information and get it out to them on all of our employees.
Anything else?
That's all I have.
Thank you, Dr. Moss.
Now, that's right, I'm sorry. I just saw and remembered, Susan, thank you. You have before you the financial update on the Lee County High School construction project. If you look at the first column, it's the revenue, the bond sale. The bonds sold were $22,677,688. So far, it's generated $19,500 in interest. It's more than that, but that's all that's been booked so far. And we've not yet applied for sales tax refunds. So the total revenue right now for the Lee County High School project is $22,697,188. The contract with American South, if you look under expenditures, is $20,439,688. The architect fee was $1,153,000. The issuance of the bond debt was $151,015. We've had reimbursements, the asbestos and other types of reimbursements outside of the contract at $43,240. As you know, we set aside $400,000 for contingency. So far out of that contingency fund, we've approved change orders in the amount of $34,007. We have pending change orders in the amount of $30,172. We anticipate the technology outside of allowances will need another $80,500. That leaves $255,321 remaining in the $400,000 contingency line item, and we're well over halfway through, and we're already out of the ground. So I don't anticipate utilizing all of the contingency, but it's still there. That leaves right now $510,245 in the revenue. When we talked about doing the auditorium outside of the contract, the four areas that we were going to do within the auditorium were the seating, the lights and sound, painting, and the curtains. We do know that the seating, you have something before you tonight, whether or not you approve it or you pull it. Because of the type of seating, that would be the wood seats, and those are the most expensive seats, and that cost is about $135,000. The lighting and the sounds, to do those according to the way the specs were drawn up with by the architect, is $131,008. So that still leaves $244,237 for painting and curtains, which is more than enough to do the painting and curtains. And those are all the known figures. I did not want to even discuss or attempt to move on the auditorium until you had an idea of where the funding is and how much funding was remaining, and to feel comfortable if you want to move forward with the auditorium. We are doing it outside of the contract, which was agreed upon at the very beginning to save us the profit and overhead for the most part. And also because it's something we can do outside of the contract. We would do it normally in any other type of school year. But I feel very comfortable if we want to proceed with the auditorium component on those four items. The funding is there. The funding has to be, by law, spent for this project. You cannot take this money and spend it on any other project or divert it to any other capital project. That would be illegal. Any question on the update?
Only a comment. It sounds as if you had the type of turnout for the spelling bee that the Dennis Wicker Civic Center, this would be an appropriate place for the next spelling bee. I think it would hold some 800 folks at the McLeod Auditorium.
And it would have definitely saved us from having to worry about the fire code. Or say Brad.
Thank you, sir. Any other?
Yes, I want to ask you a question about the about the contract, about the seat at the auditorium cost. How many do we have some bids on? How many people have bid for that?
For the seats, you do have those bids in your packet tonight. You had the three bids. For the lighting and sound, what I have right here before you is the bid that was submitted with the original contract. So I know that that is a sound figure. It was bid in accordance with the specs. So I know that the figure would not be higher than that. It could be lower than that, but it would not be any higher than that figure.
Why are we not publishing some of our bids in the paper so that we can see?
We do publish bids when we go out for bid. The lighting and sound has not been bid yet, and I'm not asking you tonight to approve lighting and sound. What is in your packet tonight is for the seating, and that has been bid out in accordance with the purchasing and contracting laws of North Carolina.
Okay. Any other questions? Thank you, Dr. Moss. It's time we get ready for our committee reports. Curriculum and instruction. Linda Smith.
Mr. Chairman, the Curriculum and Instruction Committee has not met since the last board meeting. You know, we had a compilation of two meetings of that one because of the snow. And we will be meeting tomorrow. The high school, C and I will be meeting tomorrow at Lee County High School.
Facilities and Technology, Mr. Benoit.
Mr. Chairman, Facilities and Technology Committee met on January the 25th. Mr. Tatum filled in for Mr. Smith. We discussed several matters, some change orders at the construction project at Lee County High School. Assuming everybody received the minutes and aware of those, and also item that we just discussed concerning the auditorium seating was discussed and is part of our agenda tonight under new business. And also the furniture bids for the high school, that's under the consent agenda. And also the wide area network bids, which is also under new business tonight, and we'll discuss those at that time. We also received a construction update on the project from Jerry Pittman, and it was not surprising to learn that things have gotten, you know, behind schedule due to the poor weather that we've had in December and January, and the expectation is that that time could be made up. Hopefully the weather has broken maybe after we get past this week. I know they're calling for a possibility of some more snow this week, but hopefully as the weather improves, you know, with an accelerated work schedule, the time can be made up. And the meeting was adjourned.
Thank you, sir. Finance and Personnel, Mr. Taylor.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to, first off, echo Dr. Moss's comments. I'd like the for this board to consider a challenge, a pledge to the Spelling Bee champion for their trip to Washington. For those in the audience, we're paid a handsome sum of $300 a month, and maybe we can dig deep, $350, we can dig deep and maybe come up with some money, and then I would like for the superintendent to bring to the finance committee on February 21st, maybe a matching fund from our board, from the general fund, to assist the winner for their trip, for his trip to Washington. While I'm on a challenge, I've been approached by Kale Norman, the chairman of the Lee County Education Foundation. He has asked his board to have a challenge pledge for each board member to contribute any amount that they are, or can afford to contribute to our joint venture with the head of the class project. In so doing, he's asked that I convey to this board the same challenge, any amount that you individually feel that you can contribute to the Education Foundation would be appreciated for the head of the class part. The Finance Committee met on January 27th. I'm sure that all of you have had an opportunity to see the draft of the minutes as they have been distributed. Our next meeting is February 21st, at which time they will be brought to us. The superintendent will bring to the Finance Committee the budget proposal from staff. It's the first step in the process of formulating the fiscal year budget for 2012. Again, as I did last month, invite the public, invite fellow board members to come and sit in attendance as the Finance Committee may discuss the budget proposals coming from superintendent and his staff. And also, I would like to read the following statement that I prepared, Mr. Chairman. At the meeting, I was asked as chairman to bring to the attention to Mr. Williams said he has overdrawn his personal budgeted annual allocation of $1,000. As stated in tonight's board package, the overdrawn amount is currently $194.19. As the committee has no authority to require Mr. Williams to reimburse his budgeted allocation, he has requested I bring this matter before the board tonight. And yes, Mr. Chairman and I have spoken twice today about this being brought. This is for the board's consumption. According to Policy Code 2123, board members are encouraged to participate in workshops, meetings, conventions, and other professional development activities. It further states, funds for participation shall be budgeted annually, and reimbursement for expenses shall be made in accordance with law and applicable board policy. The board on September 14, 2010, established the specific amount of money to be reimbursed at $1,000. This was in accordance with Policy 2130, which I will read portions of. This is pertaining to board members' compensation, expenses, and travel. It states the board shall annually establish a specific amount of money to be reimbursed to each board member to defray out-of-pocket expenses incurred in the performance of duties. No individual allocation may be exceeded without specific authorization by the board. At the request of the chairman, I bring this matter to the board for discussion at this time.
Ms. Taylor, just for the sake of the board and for clarity of the $193, if I was informed previously to extending over the $1,000, it may have not happened. I had no knowledge of being over $1,000, and so that's at this point that I said for Mr. Taylor to bring that to the board.
Well, I was just going to say, Mr. Chairman, and then in response to what Mr. Tatum has presented to us, that the, what is $194.19, that as a board member, I would say at this time, you know, we, you know, overlook this amount or do whatever we need to do to say to Mr. Williams that, you know, we will somehow know, I guess we can handle that somewhere internally, but after this, that any expense, you know, over, and that's for any board member, that we go over our allocated amount, that it is up to us then to pay for any workshops or, you know, staff development, whatever we have. So that would be what I would say, that would be my recommendation, that we say to Mr. Williams, forgiven this time. But however, I think, you know, all of us sort of like need to keep in mind and sort of like keep a running record of how much is spent for each workshop or step, you know.
I would just add to what Lynn said. It would be helpful too, you know, just like we get monthly statements from the bank, you know, that maybe if we had a monthly update as to where we stand on that, so that it will help us keep abreast of where we are as far as expenditures.
I would like to say the same thing, that since none of us have any information about what we have left in the account, I would feel like that might be an oversight. And if Mr. Chairman, if the chairman is doing this on behalf of the school board and is getting the training for the purpose of improving himself as a member of the board, I don't think we should ask him to pay that back. I think since he's doing that, if it's the money used for his personal purpose, that's different. But if he's using it for the purpose of improving himself as part of the school system, I will support for giving that.
I will add too, I have asked both finance officer and superintendent to prepare each month to the finance committee meeting a document. I will take exception to comments previously made. We have that document. It is in our document. It was in our package last month. It is in periodically. It is the responsibility of each board member to adhere to policies set by the board. I'm sorry if you've not seen your package. I'm sorry if you didn't read where you stand. But it is in the board package on a regular basis, but we will for certain make it available on a monthly basis starting in March, and hopefully it will continue through this fiscal year and into next year. We are going to be in a dire crisis. We have to comply with state law with a minimum of 12 hours of continuing education. We can easily afford to do that with this allocation. We have operated on $1,000 allocation annually, budgeted allocation annually for 6 years that I was chairman. This is the first time in over 6 years that any one board member that I recollect has exceeded their allocation that they are responsible for. I'm sorry if you don't read, if any one of us do not read thoroughly the entire board package and the actions taken by the board, but it is our responsibility to adhere to the policies that we ourselves have established.
Mr. Tatum, correct me if I'm wrong, but it goes in it quarterly versus monthly at this point?
It's at least quarterly, but this was in last month's package and is in again today's package. So I think that what we'll see is we will have this year every month by calendar month the individual board's reimbursement allocation.
Mr. Chairman, I might add, according to policy, if we're going to override board policy, which states that you cannot overdraw the amount, it will take a motion.
To this board, let it be clear that if I knew I was going over, we would have brought it to the board. To this board, if any member of this board knew I was going over, it should have been brought to the board. I take exception, as Mr. Tatum does, that at this point, this has come to the board. We all are responsible. I have no problem with that. But in the same token, we also have to know ahead of time. And if we have a situation, I'd been more than happy to ask to attend the training. Could I have permission to go? I did not know I was at the $1,000 at that point. And so with that said, I think what needs to be asked is there a motion to be made in reference to the situation? To forgive.
Not to forgive. The motion would be to allow the overage to whatever amount.
Mr. Chairman,
excuse me, I'm not going to chair this one, Mr. Bernardi, since it concerns me. Will you please chair that?
Mr. Vice Chairman. I would like to make a motion then that the amount of $194.19 that it be added to Mr. Williams' account.
Second. the $1,000 that
yeah, $1,000. So making it right. So the overage of $194.19 would be added to Mr. Williams' account.
We have a motion on the floor. Do we have a second?
A second.
Okay, we have a second. Is there any discussion?
Well, I don't know if I understood Mr. Williams correctly. Did you say it was like all our responsibilities to keep up with someone else's money spent? I just want to make sure I understood you. I don't think it's my responsibility to keep up with Mr. Tatum's or Mr. Bernardi's or Dr. Smith's. Did I understand you?
I'm saying it's our responsibility as a board that if we know, if an individual knows, or if collectively we know, that is brought to the board for that purpose.
Any further discussion? Okay, those in favor of the motion signify by aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign.
No.
Can we have a show of hands? Those in favor of the motion signify by raising a hand. Those opposed, likewise. Yeah, the motion is defeated. Mr. Chairman, I'll turn it back over to you.
Okay.
Was that the end of your report, Mr. Taylor?
That concludes my report for tonight.
Smith, policy.
Mr. Chairman, the policy committee met on Tuesday, January the 18th. We approved four policies. All four policies were to comply with general statute changes, and they will be presented under new business for first reading. And the next policy committee meeting is on February the 10th, 2011.
All right. And Mr. Tatum, State Board of Education.
Yes, I will hand out at this time a draft. You can hardly read the copy. But this is a drafted survey. As part of the role that I fulfilled on the state board, I'm also on a Blue Ribbon Task Force regarding compulsory attendance, raising the age of, for compulsory attendance to either 17 or 18 years old. The task force has developed this as a draft, and I'd like to ask you to take just a moment, or if it takes any longer, we'll hand in to Susan at the end of the meeting your answer to this survey so that I may collect it and carry it back to the next task force meeting in regards to the compulsory attendance. Also, I would like to think that maybe by March, as I give more information to the board, by March, maybe we can look at this board considering a resolution to be sent to the task force on the raising the compulsory attendance. I will say this, that there's much data, much research has been into this. I've pointed out to the fellow committee members in their own document of research, it would cost the state up to $300 million additional funds to raise the compulsory age. Now, I'm not one to quibble over dollars, millions, or multiples of millions when it comes to what's in the best interest of students. But I do think that the board, the commission that I serve on should take into consideration the budget restraints that the state has now and how when we are faced with a $3+ billion budget, how we can add another 10% to to a new program. I just share that with you at this point. Regarding the state board, we met on last Thursday. The The only thing I'd share with you there is that there was much accolades for Granville County Schools, and they asked each member, each of us at the state level, to schedule a visit to Granville County Schools, the two high schools, either the two high schools, Southern Granville or Oxford Webb, to observe their virtual enterprise system. Both the Superintendent of Public Instruction and the State Board Chair are very much interested in what they're doing. We had a presenter from SAS to share with us what she had observed, and it certainly sounds interesting. I do plan to go, and I extend to Dr. Linda Smith and also to Mark Akinosho, particularly on the CNI committee, and maybe Andy Bryan, not to leave out Dr. Moss, but maybe we carpool up one day and see what it is that is meant by virtual enterprise system. Also, it was suggested that local board members and administration visit DPI's webinar February 15th between 9 and 10, and I'm sorry, I don't know the details. It's just that was just a point of information that was shared. And lastly, but not least, the board, state board, adopted the guiding principles for legislation. There are five principles for the State Board of Education will ensue with the legislation, the current session. Maintain a focus on success for all students. Provide the infrastructure necessary to support student success in the operation of public schools. Ensure governance that is transparent, accountable, and effective. Use innovative, sound approaches to crafting reforms and addressing economic challenges. Provide responsible local control and flexibility. I would say for discussion that maybe in lieu of what is happening in Raleigh, that this board may want to look, Mr. Chairman, at developing our own guiding legislative principles. I think that that with what's going on, what it may be forthcoming in the legislation agenda, this board may need to have some specific guidelines rather than individually we email to a legislator, whether it's our own legislator or the leadership in the legislature, our own personal opinions of different laws being drafted. So I would think that maybe we should look at forming our own. I want for the essence of time, I won't bring up my own thoughts right now, but I'll share with you, Mr. Chairman, what I'm reading from, and maybe you and Dr. Moss can put your heads together. I know that sometimes we get emails and asking our board members to contact, and I think we need to be together on some of the guiding principles that we feel strongly about. That completes my report with the state board. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Chairman, can I ask Mr. Tatum a question about the survey?
Yes.
Mr. Tatum, when you folks were discussing questions 5, 6, and 7, I could agree that a student should be able to drop out at 16, should be able to drop out at 17, should be able to drop out of 18. Is the inference that they have to stay in school to that long because those questions are not real clear?
Dr. Moss, we spent 2.5 hours on this survey, and it wasn't clear after 2.5 hours. And there's 13 members of that commission, and we went around and around that the the statements are not clear. There are facilitator finally admitted it was just an opinion. They were just reaching for an opinion. And so that's what we're doing is.
I don't know what they're going to know when they get the results.
Well, John, that's what we came to the conclusion, that when you get the results, what are you going to do with it? Because the questions are so ambiguous as to an opinion held by an individual. And frankly, some of the questions that was pointed out, I made reference to, some of them only administrators in the school system could answer. The layperson cannot answer. Some questions may be good for students, but not more than about three of the questions. I think there are 18. I don't think about three of them could even pertain to a student. So how do you assimilate? But nonetheless, this is what was given to us. I just thought it was interesting to present it to this board, to individually. I will say that I did ask. We didn't go anywhere with it, but I did, after about 2 hours, hour and a half, I asked maybe that we, each one of us at the meeting, answer the survey and pass it in and let the facilitator digest and see if there was any semblance of order from the responses, which I still find it difficult, and I think you will too as you read the survey.
You know, I think if just looking at this, it would have been so much better, I know it's after the fact now, that a survey would have been done for each of the groups listed above, because so many of the questions, are relevant just for, just for the students. And, if you want to really try to validate information, then I think you need to go to the group that can validate this information for you.
And Linda, that's the purpose of handing it out to this board. I would welcome you contacting me because, as I said, this is a draft. The draft letters didn't copy well. This is a draft, and nothing is in concrete yet. We may be going back to the drawing board on the on where we are.
Anything else from Mr. Taylor? Thank you, sir.
I will say, this is an interesting sidebar of being at the state level. They have spent unbelievable amount of time, this committee. This committee was formed before. This committee was formed last fall. And it's time to bring the committee to an end, in my opinion. But I'm just one voice.
They've been meeting since when?
Last fall.
Last fall.
This is
that's their product.
They're not being paid. State board.
Yeah, they get paid.
The facilitator. The rest of us are not. And some on the board are driving from Mitchell County, Catawba County. I mean, it's a full day's trip. Leaving 5 in the morning and getting home at 9 at night or 8 at night.
Well, from maybe just the comment side issue section might be the most appropriate place to fill out.
All right.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. I entertain a motion at this time for the approval of the consent agenda.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second. Move properly second that we would approve the consent agenda. All those in favor, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, you have the same sign. Unfinished business, Mr. Smith.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the Lee County Board of Education approve the second reading of policies 4100, 4335, 4400, and 5070.
It's coming from committee, doesn't need a second. All those in favor, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
Those of you have the same sign, ayes have it. Dr. Smith, policy first reading.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the Lee County Board of Education approve the first reading of policies 5027, 5030, 6340, and 8701.
Again, coming from committee, any questions? All those in favor, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposes? Ayes have it. Lee County High School Auditorium Chairs, John Benoit.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the Lee County Board of Education award the purchase of 837 wood back and wood seat auditorium chairs with 100 arm tablets at Lee County High School to Perfection Equipment Company in the amount of $135,409.
This is coming from FNT. You've heard the motion. Any discussion?
Yes.
Yeah, I got some. Go ahead.
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
Ms. Tatum, then.
Ms.
Tatum, then.
Yes, I'd like to have some discussion in this regard. This was brought to F&T the day that I substituted for Dr. Smith. I've had, at that time, I had thoughts and concerns. I have since asked Mr. Bernardi to place it on new business so that we could have better discussion. While I understand the points that's made about the wood seat, the wood back, and the retro appearance to the 1950s, I can't miss the opportunity of expressing. The McLeod Auditorium is a venue that I think that many people in the community will be able to use. Probably more use by the community than Mr. Batten, his students, or his staff. I would think that auditorium, as we worked to get the quarter cent sales tax passed, many people in the community saw that as a luxury item for Lee County High School. As I worked and campaigned for the quarter cent, a lot of people had a lot of conversation, particularly the old line natives of Lee County, remembering the use of McLeod Auditorium for North Carolina Symphony. We just heard tonight, the fire marshal had to ask parents and family to leave the auditorium at the Civic Center. I think what we're going to see in there are a lot of parents and grandparents frequenting the auditorium. I think that the auditorium is going to be a great asset to all education of Lee County, particularly with arts and theater, both for Lee County High School students, but also Southern Lee High School students. I believe that we will also see the North Carolina Symphony reappearing, possibly annually, to Lee County because of the improvements of that venue. For that reason, I just ask that the board to consider the use and what group will be the most in the community to use it. Students at Lee County High School or adults in the community.
So, I don't know who the question would be better directed to, Mr. Bernardi or the superintendent, but either one answer. Why did we decide to go with the wood? Why did we?
That would probably the recommendation that we made from staff. It's a variety of reasons. One is durability. Second one is sanitation. You can wipe down the wood. It'd be sanitized. If you have the cloth like we have in here or anywhere else, if things get spilled on it, moisture, mildew issues, if they get wet, the upkeep, the maintenance. If you look at the seats that are over right now, I believe they were cushioned and vinyl, and you can see where students have poked, cut. The seats are in very bad condition. Same thing can happen with the cloth. It's real difficult to cut through the wood unless you're sitting there with a saw. So all those issues that were taken into consideration when we made the recommendation for the longevity of how long the seats would stay in there. Of course, the cloth seats are cheaper, believe it or not.
And that's not where I was going. I spoke with the...
And I will, Mr. Cameron, I will say that late this afternoon I received an email from Greg Batten, and his teachers prefer cloth seats. They don't want wooden seats either.
Well, I spoke to someone, the head of the drama, you know, classmate of mine contacted me, and and said he thought the wood would be just like the wooden seats over at Bubba's or Little Dino's. It would be, people would be carving, putting magic marker, you know, writing, and thinks they would end up like that. And then he didn't really see a lot of use for the arm tablets. I mean, you may, but that's just what he said. But I think he preferred the cloth seats, and that's just all I'll say about it.
Mr. Chairman, if I might weigh in, when I came to Sanford 30 years ago, McLeod Auditorium was really the place to go for public functions. And of course, it has lost its appeal over the years. And if we apply the Fanny test to those chairs, there's no question that those seats get hard. And if we're going to reattract the public, and particularly the performing arts parents and grandparents who are attending there, you know, I guess we kind of have to look at it kind of like the laptops. You know, there's some built-in maintenance. Maybe we just need to build in some maintenance, admitting that damage will occur. I would prefer to see the cloth seats.
And I was just going to ask, now with the new technology, most of your cloth seats now, aren't they, like I said, water, your scars guarded, yeah, for protection
to a certain point,
but easily clean. Am I not correct? If they have that on them? I know when you buy furniture now, that's one of the things you waste something on. It just sort of like run right on off, and it doesn't make a stain.
I don't know about the cleanliness. I don't know about how easily they are to clean. I would think that it's like a rug or anything else you have. You get an upholstery attacher and you clean it that way if you have to. Probably a little bit more expensive to clean than if they were just wood, where you're wiping them down with a cleaning agent, because you're having to go to each one individually with some kind of steam or moisture component or moisture additive. But if the board wanted to make a substitute motion, it just, as you're entering your discussion, the low bid still would be with the same company. And if you look at your bid amounts, you have the option, while you're in discussion mode, the seat with cushion back end seat is $112,158. We do believe that we need about 100 arm tablets, and that would equate to three classes. Right now they have three classes in there, and if you're going to write, it'd be nice to flip up in an arm tablet and have those arm tablets. To have just the wood back and a padded seat is $124,713. So it's still the same company, as you're entering your discussion, if you end up with a substitute motion on purchasing seats, if you want cushion back end seat, or wood back and cushion seat, or wood back and wood seat.
And what would be the cost of, how many tablets did you say, 100?
100 is what we're calculating, which is $4,000. That remains constant on every seat.
So if we have, if I'm understanding, you would have on cushioned seats and cushioned backs, it would be $112,000?
112,158 plus four, so 116,158.
Well, excuse me, Dr. Moss, would not you also need to add in the 6696 for removal?
Yeah, that's right. So it'd be 118.
It would be the 131,409 plus the $4,000, so that'd be 135,409.
No, sir. That's for wood. If it's cushion, it's 118. 118,854 plus 4,000, so 122.
Dr. Moss or Mr. Bernardi, did any other company bid for cushion seats beside this one?
Yes, they're all. The rest of them all were cushioned.
The other ones are all cushioned.
Yeah.
Which you can see, some of them actually were higher than the wood seats.
Yeah, the Red Hill Distributor is $139,000.
They were the only ones that had wood. The rest of them were cushioned.
Okay, but they all was bidding on wood. Okay. Price of the all. Okay.
That's what I'm saying. Your low bidder is still the same company, just whatever type of seating you want.
You've heard the motion from F&T. Any other discussion?
Would it be appropriate if I made an amended motion to the motion on the floor, or should we vote this motion one way or the other?
You can make an amendment to the motion.
Then I'd like to make an amended motion that we go with cushion seats, cushion back, with 100 tablets for the 122,000 and whatever. What?
118,854.
It's an addition, but you have to add the 4,000. Yeah. So it's 122,854.
No, sir.
You have it 118,000 plus removal. You got 112 plus removal. You go 118,854.
That's already. Add the
4,000.
4,000 tablets.
So it's
122,854.
122,854. 822,854. 822,854. So my amended motion would be going with cushion front, cushion seat, cushion back, with 100 tablets to perfection equipment for $122,854.
You've heard the amended motion.
Mr. Chairman, I believe it'd be a substitute motion.
Substitute.
That's exactly. Amended, because the only person can amend would be him. Okay. Or he agrees.
Substitute.
Now we have to vote the substitute motion up or down.
That's right. That's the way
and
I
then, okay. Sure. You've heard the substitute motion made. Do I have a second?
I second that.
Hold on. Yeah. We substitute motion has been made and been properly seconded. Mr. Mark Akinosho.
No, I didn't.
Glenn Smith.
Okay.
Who made the second?
Any second? Glenn Smith. Okay. All right. You've heard the substitute motion. Any discussion? Mr. Akinosho.
Yeah, I was just thinking that since we have the, we need to vote on his first motion.
No. Am I correct?
Vote on substitute motion.
Substitute motion first.
Okay.
All right. So, you've heard substitute motion. Been moved properly second. All those in favor, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
Pose the same sign. So the substitute motion is that we will purchase the cushion seats for $122,854, which includes 100 tablets. That is not a motion that's on the floor.
You've already voted.
Just passed.
Which makes the original motion move.
So it's done.
It makes original motion
Thank
move
you.
Because you've just approved.
Thank you, Mr. Attorney. All right. Next order is Mr. Bernardi again. Wide Area Network contract.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the Lee County Board of Education approve the in-stream contract for our wide area network for a monthly fee of $84,207.60 for 3 years.
It's coming from F&T. Does not require a second. Any discussion?
Yes, I'd like to point out to those in the audience and that with the E-rate discount, is at $67,366.08. The actual cost of Lee County School, if I'm correct, Cindy, is $16,841.52. That's not a substitute motion. The motion on the floor stands. I just point that out for the public consumption.
Mr. Chairman, I think it might be appropriate at this time if maybe Ms. Johnson could just re-familiarize us about the E-rate funding and maybe some of those in the audience aren't aware what E-rate funding is and how much it means to this district.
Sure.
That's all right.
E-rate is a federal reimbursement program that is designed to help schools with connectivity, and that funding is actually generated across the country on your telephone bills. Whenever you pay your bill, if you'll notice where it says either FCC fund or universal service fund, that's where they collect the money that is distributed to schools and public libraries. There is a fairly intense application process that we go through that I estimate takes about a tenth of my work year, but certainly well worth the money. The discount is based on our free and reduced lunch status, and so that varies from school system to school system and in Lee County from year to year. We are now at an 80% discount, which is the highest we've ever been.
In terms of dollars, Cindy, what, I'm not, won't hold you to exact, but what roughly does that mean to Lee County school system?
Well, I don't know what it will mean for the year that we're applying
history.
For, because I haven't quite finished with applications for the next year, but I think we'll hit about $1 million in funding for the current school year. If we don't hit it, we're going to be just a dollar or two shy.
Thank you. Any other discussion? All those in favor, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
Those you have the same sign, ayes have it. Dr. Moss.
Mr. Chairman, there was one thing I failed to mention during the superintendent's report. In keeping in line with some of the language of my contract, I have to inform you that I have been invited to participate in a discussion on February 24th with a group out of Washington, D.C. on formulating new laws to help navigate through exceptional children issues. Part of that is not a consulting fee, but it is they are offering a $1,000 honorarium. I am not going to accept that. I'm going to have them write that check to the Lee County Educational Foundation. So I'm not accepting it personally, but I am supposed to inform you if I do anything outside of Lee County schoolwork and in any way there's any kind of monetary assessment to that. And I guess also to ask you if you have a problem with me working with that group and having them write the check to Lee County Educational Foundation.
How long are you going to be gone?
4 hours in Raleigh. It's not going to be in Washington, D.C. It's going to be in Raleigh.
Ms. Sharp, I think you have the motion.
I do. I move that the Lee County Board of Education go into closed session for the purpose of discussing information that is privileged, confidential, or not a public record under North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318-11A1.
Benoit.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the Lee County Board of Education approve the Human Resources Report as presented.
Second.
We move the property second that we would approve the Human Resources Report as presented. All those in favor, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
All the same sign.
I move we'll be adjourned.
Second.
Beating.
That's not adjourned. I was wondering what was wrong down at that end of the table.